Hello, Narnach here, and welcome back to Path of Exile. A small patch has landed today, patch 2.2.1f, and it made small changes to the currency tab. You now have a slot in here that you can put an item into. So the intention is that you can use it for your current crafting project. So this is the astral plate I found last episode. I've been doing some work on it. I cleaned it. I managed to roll 5 sockets in on it, 4 link it. Rolled it as a rare. Rerolled it a couple times. It's still not as good as what I currently have. So I'll need more chaos to make something nice out of it. But this is nice just to keep your current project in here. It's a nice thing, and they changed the layout a bit. I think these two are now here rather than only the Mirror of Calandra. And I think the idea was to prevent accidentally using currency items that you didn't really intend to use. So that's nice. And on the bottom, you now got 5 free form things that you can use, like, for example, Perandus coins. So I'm very happy with that. I can actually keep my coins in here with my rest of my currency. So, well, that's all I wanted to show for here. For the rest, gonna have some fun. We're gonna have fun invading Kaom's dream. And depending on how long it takes, we might also push Dereso afterwards.
The ancestors would weep to see what Kaom has created here.
So this is gonna be very, very exciting. I'm actually curious to see if I've been making this into a bigger deal than I thought it would be, or if I'm actually underestimating just how much of a deal this is going to be. Either way, at the end of this episode we'll know. Also, there is a ghost here. Magnus Stonethorn, who has been possessed by a cultist. I think he was one of the uniques that I still needed to see. Oh, lore, get out. And I saw there was a unique that dropped, but first I wanna get out the things that are shooting chaos damage at me and hurting me quite a bit. Right, let's go back. We got a gold ring. Looks like a dice. And we found a bunch of rares here. Colossus Mallet, might as well pick it up, right? And wisdom. It's always good to have some wisdom. Let's see, what's this? What's this dice? Ventor's Gamble. It's a pretty low base rarity. 6%. 33% 33 max life, extra quantity, reduced rarity, so that matches what the inherent the implicit rarity is, so there's basically net no effect. Well, actually it's reduced, not increased, so might actually be worse. A whole bunch of extra fire resistance and negative lightning resistance. This is a quirky one. Let's keep it at that. Hey, let's keep going. We are the Juggernaut. We will not be stopped, except for shiny loot. Juggernaut will always stop for shiny loot. Let's see, this is a level 68 area. I'm still 69, so I'm plus 1, but it's not like I'm completely overleveled for the area anymore. I had that in some of the earlier areas, but I completely resolved that problem by just advancing rapidly through the game. Up until Act 3, things just... I was blitzing through. That's why I named half of this this playthrough just blitzing, just the blitzing arc. But now that we've arrived in Act 4, the blitzing is over. We definitely have to just pay attention. And it's probably part of the reason is that my gear is still the same gear as I was using. In late Cruel. It hasn't really updated since. And I don't really have a lot of currency to improve it, so I guess my gear on a certain level, it's still pretty decent gear if I can't easily roll new rares to improve on it. I think that's always a good test of your gear. If it's hard to make an upgrade, then you probably have decent gear. Or, of course, you have gear that has excellent rolls but terrible base stats. That's also an option. Let's see, that's an end. Let's continue, just chasing the edge here.
I cannot do this yet.
In terms of just effective resistances, I'm capped in combat. Chaos is still a weakness, of course. But both Kaom and Daresso are... No, one is fire, the other is physical based to a large extent. And I think Kaom or Daresso also has some cold damage in there. But as far as I know, none of them do heavy chaos damage. So my... Puny chaos resistance should not be too much of an issue. Yeah, look there, reflecting, blessing of elements, totem, thingamajig. More little ones to smash. Smash! Ah, this encounter, torch oak. This is also a very nice test, just to see how well I'm tanking things. If I'm not capable of tanking, then this is a very, very, very painful encounter. Also, I think there's still one alive. Yes, I missed one. Oh no. Okay, and I'm just completely overflowing with loot. Let's and we found Kaom's path. Too much loot. That's a common issue. Probably just should stop picking up just random rares that are not worth all that much to me. Just pick up the more compact ones. Let's see, this is a big hammer. It's level 60 hammer though. Yeah, we'll just keep it because we got it. But for the rest, let's just stick to more compact items. And just focus more on just picking up the raw currency. Like orb of alteration. Normally you need to pick up like 3 or 4 different rares to get a single orb, if you're unlucky. So if you just find it as it is, you don't need the orbs. Or you don't need the rares. Also, totem is a pretty nice way to keep enemies distracted. And to deal some extra damage to those hard to reach enemies, or just deal extra damage to the tough ones. This is a tough bugger, but he had life regen, that probably explains why he was still able to stay alive. Fall orb, augment. Okay, and you. Yes, got them all.
I cannot do this yet.
Okay, level up. That's good, that's more life. I actually hit that before I head down. Yes, 38, It's refreshing, because this is where Triskiriaki is gonna be. Hammer time! Also, I think we managed to kill his tails. Ah, poor blue fella. You're not really anything without your tails, are you? Yeah, okay. That's per my new policy. Just gotta stop picking up the larger items. Ooh, superior immortal call. Well, the other day I got a comment of someone asking why I don't use Immortal's Call in my Cosmic Damage Taken setup. Because a lot of builds actually benefit from it. And actually I did the math for it. And it turns out against most sources of physical damage, I effectively have like a 94-95% physical damage reduction already. Because of the interesting stacking from armor, endurance charges, fortify, and arctic armor. So I'm already reducing most of the damage, and all Immortal Call does is for a very short duration. It will boost your physical damage mitigation to 100%, that's all it does. Your physical damage mitigation is 100%, so you don't take physical damage for the 3 to 5 seconds that it lasts, depending on how many endurance charges it consumes. But this build, I heavily use endurance charges as a resource. Most of my Juggernaut abilities boost the effectiveness. And we can pick it up again. Yes. So most of the class abilities of the Juggernaut have some interaction with endurance charges. They either grant me more, they grant me damage when I have them, they give me elemental damage reduction when I am at full capacity. So I'm really rewarded for just having as many of those charges as possible all the time. So Immortal Call, it consumes them. So you lose the physical damage reduction, you lose the elemental resistance boost, in my case I lose a bunch of regen, I lose a bunch of extra damage, I lose the elemental reduction on top of the resistances. And as a result, I think just mathematically speaking, I lose more defenses and I lose some offense as well in exchange for a very small amount of added defensiveness. So for this build I don't think it's worth it. And as a result, it's another skill slot I can use for something else. Hey, hello there. Let's first clear things around here, since it's getting a bit hectic. Yes. Boom, boom, boom. Boom, all the things. Ah, a bunch of small ones. Okay. What do you have to say for yourself? A crimson jewel for 35 of the things. You know what? That's a good enough reason to go to town, empty my pockets, and get some extra coins to get a jewel. I don't have a lot of rare jewels, so getting one more of those is a pretty decent deal. Ooh, this is pretty decent in terms of resists, but it doesn't really add a lot of other things. So. And of course, selling a 6-socket item for currency is always a good deal.
I'm watching you.
Da, 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 da. We have some Some gem stuff that we can sort away, a unique item, and the coins we actually wanted more. I think I need that 3 more coins to get to 35.
Allow me to turn your coins.
Yay.
Oh, and refund is useful. My vocabulary.
Extra crit chance with lightning skills, crit mult with lightning skills, stun duration on enemies and area damage. So if you're like the lightning tribal, lightning call thingamajig, that might be pretty decent. You could do pretty decent spike damage with it. Storm call, that's the skill. Tribal, why am I thinking of tribal? Ah, of course, there's a tribal MTX for it or something. That's probably why I have to think of tribal. It's been quite a while since I actually played a lightning call build. Gee, guys, could you maybe behave a little? I did not have my defenses up, yes. Chaos Bonds. Also one of those things that I'm not very keen to jump into. Because they might actually hurt me. That was actually a rare golem that dropped down from the sky. Oh, come on. Yep. Also, it resists fire. Stop running away. Be brave and die. Thank you. Also, we have the plumed golden horde. We got a 6 socket citadel. Also not a bad deal. This is terrible, level 67. That's also one of the high-end items. Maybe even the highest end item. Citadel is level 58. Okay, so that's a lower tier. At least I got my golem now. That's good. And a royal burgonet. That's the highest end strength based / armor based helmet you can get. It requires level 65. Gives you 300 armor. I think the semite helmet is a couple tiers lower. So yet another project to craft with. I think in terms of actual content, it's taking a bit longer than I had expected to get to Kaom's hidey place. So I think we're just gonna run a Kaom today and we'll keep the rest off for the next episode. Tension rises. Got a bit of extra time to mentally prepare myself. Let's keep it at that. It's funny to see my life. It drops down to about a quarter in initial engagements because I don't have my fortify up, because I don't have my endurance charges up. And then once I got everything up, then my regen kicks in and I just completely recharge to full and my life just not move. It's in the beginning of the fight is when I'm actually at my weakest. Which is something to keep in mind if you're playing this build or a similar build yourself. Once you get going, you are really hard to stop. But before you get going, you better watch out. Okay. Let's go that way. we can go upstairs. Up is always good. Also, just opening up a battle with an Enduring Cry is a very good way to get some of your defensiveness up as well. Just because it boosts. If you're lucky, you actually get all 7 Endurance charges out of it. And if you are maxed that way, it will also kick in the benefits of extra elemental damage reduction. Freezing Shrine. Someone lost a tail. It is you. So I used to be convinced that the Rakango tails regenerated. So after you killed it, that it will just respawn one. But I haven't really seen that lately. So I think that that's either I had just completely the wrong idea in my head, or it actually used to work like that and they just changed it. But I'm actually happy that Rakango tails don't regenerate themselves. So that would of course be an evil mod to have them actually regenerate their tails. So this one leeches life and it regenerates life, and it's actually resisting my efforts to kill it pretty darn well. Also, it has temporal change up, so my attacks go slower, therefore dealing less time. And here we are here, Caldera of the King. All hail the King. Well, me. Not you. Okay, so I don't have any charges, and Kaom was still quote-unquote friendly when I engaged him. So I could not refresh my charges in time, so I'm just slowly casting my Enduring Cry to keep the charges up. On the other hand, tanking him pretty darn well. And actually the good thing about the Hyrie is that I can call more. Let's see, kill you guys all now. Yes, please. Good. Yes, you smash. I am not impressed.
Come, my ancestors! I cannot do this again.
So these summon skulls are also a very nice thing, because you're just smashing them in the process of killing the boss itself. So they are not as annoying as other builds that actually have to deal with them or face the consequences. And probably similarly, if you're playing a Reeve build or something, I'm intentionally trying to not drink any potions just to see how well my natural tank holds up here. And that went pretty darn well. Definitely took longer than I'd expected, and it took his damage wasn't as bad. No, first 3/4 of the fight I don't think he pushed me below like 90% of my life. I think his hits were like 200, maybe 400 damage. Later on in the fight, you noticed that things were stacking a bit more. He did a bit more damage and he pushed me to about half or a third down. But still, it wasn't that bad. And he started attacking a bit faster, so the damage started stacking a bit more. But I'm pretty content with how this went. Yes, there's the eye. So now we say hello to Lady Diala, get rid of the eye. And we got that one in the bag. So we had red, next episode we'll have blue. But that's gonna be next episode. So I'm gonna thank you very much for watching. And next episode is gonna be the exciting one. So don't go anywhere. Bye bye.